Good.
Yep.
All right, guys. Welcome back to TCI Headquarters. Davis, Sam, Robert. If you just want to turn off the last minute of this video when we give the predictions, I understand, especially my part. Not going in the 60s this week, but we got a huge, 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 huge game. The coaches like to say it's the biggest game of the year, but this really is maybe the biggest game of the year. We're going to try to break down some keys and things we expect to see in it. Go on the limb, give you guys our predictions. Davis, I'm going to start with you. You know, what are some of the keys for this week's matchup?
I think it's going to be – one of the biggest ones is how this offense responds to what NC State does defensively. Because, again, Dabo and this coaching staff still talked a lot this week about the way that Georgia Tech, you know, schemed against this Clemson offense and, you know, playing the odd man front and dropping into, you know, seven or eight into coverage and playing, you know, cover three and quarters and all this stuff to try to keep everything in front of them with this Clemson offense and not trying to give up the big play. Tony Elliott said, you know, NC State's defense is a lot like that. They play basically a 3-3-5 stack. So, you know, he expects, particularly with how effective Georgia Tech was with that, he expects NC State and a lot of other teams, if Clemson can't adjust to it and can't perform any better, to throw that defensive look at them time and time again. So, to me, yes, there's different elements of the passing game that you can you know, implement and that they need to implement. But to me, the biggest key to this is the push that the offensive line gets. Because if they're going to be dropping, you know, seven or eight in the coverage, you've got to run the ball mostly against that. And if they can't rip off 5 or 6, 7 yards of carry against, you know, 4 or 5 man boxes, there's no reason for defenses in the back end to adjust what they're doing. The offensive line's got to get more push. Even if the offensive line at this point in the season is not far enough along to do that, maybe you get DJ more involved with the power run game like he did the second half against Georgia Tech. I think 7 of his 8 runs were in that second half, and it was just enough of a look in the running game to put them over the top ultimately. So maybe that's something else. Maybe DJ gets 10, 11 carries. I don't know. But they've got to be able to run the ball more effectively because everything else predicates off of that. Because you've got to force the defense his hand, and you've got to make them change what they're doing. I mean, DJ said it earlier this week, if they're going to play that defense, you've got to run it out of them. So I think that's one of the biggest keys is how does this team, you know, now particularly with Will Shipley now being the starter and Kobe Pace being their top two primary backs now with Lynn J. Dixon out of the picture, how does this running game perform?
Well, Coach Venables was one of the guys that kind of brought this defense to everybody several years ago, and then Iowa State kind of copied it. And so, you know, he'll certainly throw it at them in practice all week long.
Yeah.
So they're going to see it. And I don't know how they did, how they adjusted, but that's definitely a big key. Sam, what are you looking for as keys?
Well, I'm just looking for how they're going to respond, you know, offensively, obviously. I know Davis touched on it, but I think, you know, DJ coming into this week has talked, and Tony Elliott has talked about the fundamentals and just getting down the basics. I mean, we talked about it in our last segment, but, you know, he's just got to, his footwork just has to be better, and he's, you know, sailing some throws that he has to make. And I think it's just getting, I mean, we talked about this over and over again, and we can talk in blue in the face, just getting back to the basics and completing those short intermediate passes and, you know, moving the chains. And as cliche as it sounds, I mean, they just have to be able to move the football down the field, and they haven't been able to do that consistently. And if you can't show that against an NC State team, I don't know who you're going to be able to show it against. But that being said, NC State has a very experienced defense. I think 9 of the 11 guys are returning starters. Granted, they're missing, you know, their linebacker who, you know, could throw his hat in the ring to being ACC Defensive Player of the Year. He's a great player. He's out for the season with a shoulder injury, I believe. But, yeah, they have a very experienced defense. I'm sure they're going to throw similar looks that Georgia Tech gave them. And, you know, Matt Bockhorst said earlier this week, if they want to show it to us, then we'll spot the ball and let's go. But Davis said, while we were on Facebook Live earlier, there's a difference between spotting the ball and actually executing. So they just have to get the offense in a rhythm. And I know it's easier said than done, but if they want to win this in a tough atmosphere in a game on the road, it's as simple as that. And it's about, you know, being able to run the football effectively more than, you know, they said they were able to run the football, but they only averaged 3.9 yards per carry. It has to be better than that, especially when, you know, you're out with Lynn J. Dixon and you need guys like Shipley and Pace to kind of take that to the next level. And they just have to be more creative offensively. They just have to get into a rhythm. And like I said, it's simple, but it's what needs to happen in order to beat NC State.
I think one thing that's interesting, too, that Tony Elliott talked about is because Brandon Streeter, the quarterback's coach, has said that DJ's got the best arm talent of any quarterback Clemson's ever had. And when you have that kind of arm strength, it's so easy to just rely on talent more than your fundamentals. And that's one of the big things that Tony said that both he and Brandon Streeter are working with DJ on is don't get lackadaisical with your fundamentals. Mm-hmm. Don't just try to get by on talent because this is FBS football. This is Power 5 football. That's not going to work here.
Yep.
You know, you've got to incorporate the fundamentals and details into everything that you're doing. And that's the biggest key, I think, right now with DJ and some of those longer throws. Now, the defense has dictated some of that. Why they haven't tried to stretch the field as much, but there's still been three or four throws a game, intermediate to deeper routes that have been there, and they just have been fairly wide off the mark. Mm-hmm. So, you got to be able to incorporate a little bit of that too, in what you're doing offensively.
I think the first quarter is going to be huge in this game because of the crowd. I don't think Clemson can go in there and afford to let this game be a nail biter going into the fourth quarter. I think Clemson needs to come out, needs to gain some confidence on the offensive side, needs to kind of come back and kind of make a statement and say, hey guys, we're still king of the ACC. We still can do this thing. I'm going to go out on a limb and say I'm actually expecting DJ to have his best game of the year. I think he's heard all the stuff. He's dealt with all the stuff. He certainly has played better. We saw it at Notre Dame. We have seen it before. A lot of what you said, just the footwork and those things, he knows what to do. Obviously, mm-hmm. he's getting in situations on the field where he's not doing that. Again, like I said earlier, Ross coming along a little bit. Now you kind of got your – I think Clemson's better off saying, hey, we're going to make Shipley the guy.
Yeah.
And Kobe's going to come in relief. And, just – they need that chemistry.
Yeah.
And I think now maybe we're going to start to see that a little bit better. Ross came on last week. They're going to have to find a way to move the ball through the air, whether it's short passes. But they've got the athletes to do that. So they'll have a much better game plan. I think the key to this game is going to be, I don't want to put it all on DJ, but obviously the offensive line's big. But DJ's got to play good, and he's got to handle. We can't have the fumbles. We can't have the drop snaps. He's going to have to be able to handle calling the plays with the crowd. I mean, NC State – it's not Clemson, doesn't have 80,000, but as far as ACC venues go, it's one of the louder places you can go. So that, and they're smelling that, hey, they're not going to fear Clemson coming in there this week when, Clemson can't just walk in with their chest stuck out like they do a lot of years. Everybody's feeling Clemson vulnerable, so they're going to be ready.
Oh, yeah. I think if you've watched Clemson play, I'm sure NC State thinks they're ripe for the picking. Mm-hmm. But you mentioned a good point about some of the fumbles. I mean, again, they've put the ball on the ground 11 times in three games, and two of those games have been at home, mm-hmm. where it's been pretty quiet when they've had the ball offensively. So, they can't afford keep turning the ball over and putting the ball on the ground. I mean, the fact they've only lost two, that's sort of blowing my mind. I mean, you put the ball on the ground 11 times, you think you'd lose at least half of
and
those.
And defense is great, but
you can't put them in bad situations. But offensive line, yes, DJ needs to play better, but I think part of that is the offensive line, too. Again, I think when you talk about cohesion, that's the group that has to gel the most.
Mm-hmm.
And even Tony Elliott talked about, there's things that DJ's got to work on fundamentally with his footwork, but a part of that is feeling comfortable in the pocket behind the line that's protecting you. And, that Georgia game, it was rough. And you wonder, he's got some happy feet going on, if there's sort of a carryover effect from that game and the way that, the offensive line is as performed as a whole. Just is he comfortable behind that line right now?
Well, and I think that's one of the reasons Davis Allen's getting the start, because I think
point.
He's a better blocker than Braden Galloway. And I noticed last week they were having him in there a lot to help that offensive line. So if that's the case, then obviously you want your best blocker in there, especially on the road.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
All right, guys. Let's get a final thought from you guys and a prediction.
Again, I keep, like, they're, yes, the defense has not been perfect, but defense is not their problem. Haven't given up a defensive touchdown, so I continue to go back to the offensive side of the ball and the offensive line. If they can't
run, like a broken record.
But the offensive line, I think it's the whole key to them being more better on offense, because everything else is predicated on that. And again, if NC State takes the same defensive approach that Georgia Tech did, if they've got to be able to run the ball better, they've got to, or else again, there's no reason for NC State or even defenses they're going to face in the future to alter from that, mm-hmm. alter from that plan. You got to give defenses a reason to do that. So I don't know if they're going to do that. I do think NC State ends Clemson's touchdownless streak. I think they find the end zone once, but ultimately, I think Clemson's collection of talent, I think they're able to make one more play at the end. I'm going to say 19-13, Clemson.
Dumb, I'm going to be sweating it on the sidelines.
I think a lot of people are going to be sweating. A lot of Clemson fans are going to be sweating.
19-13?
Yeah, that's what I'm going with. Yeah. I just haven't seen enough from this offense. I have to see them do it.
They have to prove it.
Yeah, they have to prove it to me for me to think that they're actually going to have an explosion on offense.
Yeah, to go off that point, I don't think we've seen enough to make a prediction that the offense gives you enough comfort to make this, that this is going to be a closer game. It'll probably be a closer game than it should be. If Clemson can – I mean, granted, like Davis said, it's not all on the defense, but if they can force defensive turnovers and – you know, be able to effectively, consistently have drives that lead in touchdowns. Obviously, I think they'll win this game. But if you go back to the way Mississippi State played them, yeah, there was a kickoff return for a touchdown on the first play of the game, but then they also forced three turnovers, and that was the game there. So if they can force some turnovers from Devin Leary, who's a good quarterback, he's an experienced veteran guy who, you know, might be one of the better quarterbacks in the conference that they face this year, but I think Clemson, as Davis said, I think they make one more play than NC State does. I think their defense is going to keep them in every game this year, and I think this one as well. I have Clemson winning 24-20.
And that the one thing the defense has not done yet, as good as it's been, is score its own touchdown.
If they do that, we'd be in better shape.
I mean, and they might need it this game. Yeah, they might need it this game.
Or a special teams one.
All right. Believe it or not, I'm not going in the 60s this week. I think, as you said, I think NC State offense is going to have some opportunities. I think they've got one of the better passing games that Clemson's faced this year. Georgia's obviously would be better with all their players, but they didn't have them. This one's a tough one. For some reason, my gut's telling me DJ's going to step up. I know he can play much better than he has. As you said, though, if the offensive line's not blocking, it may not matter a whole lot. I think Clemson will win the game. I think it's going to be a close one at the half, but I think Clemson they're more talented. We haven't necessarily seen that translate to how they performed on the field, but Clemson knows what's at stake this week. They know. They're hearing all the noise. Yeah. They're hearing it from the coaches. I think the coaches have tried to be very careful to not mess up the psyche of the team and not just totally get all over them. Mm-hmm. So they know what's on the line. Bockhorst let everybody know that in his interview this week. So I think the Tigers will pull it out. I think I will be sweating during this game and worried about it. But I'm going to go Clemson 21, which for me is like nothing. NC State 13. I think we're all expecting a
for low scoring
these two teams, a low scoring game. And it's because of, I'm always just know Clemson's got all this talent. They're going to go out and score all these points because I've seen it so many times over the last 6 years. But now I'm at the point where you got to prove it to me again.
Just hadn't seen it this year.
Yeah, got to prove it. Different team, different players.
Talking about two teams that have very solid defenses as well, though. So, I mean, besides the offense struggling.
Yeah, and then being on the road for the first time, truly.
All right, so we'll see. Hopefully we're all right on the outcome. I mean, the good news is we've been, except for the Georgia game, so I guess I can't say that. Last 2 weeks, we've been right on the outcome, but very wrong on the scores. But that's why we play the games. I don't think anybody expected what we saw last week in Death Valley for the home opener. And hopefully this week will be nobody expected the outcome where Clemson just goes out and rolls NC State and looks like they're back. But we'll see. We'll find out. Have everything covered all week long for you. Stay tuned to TCI for the most complete coverage of Clemson recruiting and Clemson athletics.
This is Miles Murphy. Make sure to check out Clemson Insider's most complete football coverage. Nobody does it better.